Hi guys! Two notes to make before we start. First, wow, thanks again for getting my channel up to 1,000 subs. If my timing calculations are right, it seems I most likely should thank, and forgive me for my mangling of Irish pronunciation, Eamon Sheehan for sharing my videos on his Facebook and Twitter feeds. It seems it was right then that my subs took off. I hope soon to give some of that back in the form of a special video, but it will now have to wait until the current series is over. Also, if you are a longtime viewer of my channel, you might find this video a bit familiar, as it covers a lot of material already covered in earlier videos, albeit in more detail. This is more of an introductory video to cover the basics before we move on to material I haven't covered yet. There's quite a lot to get through, but before we begin, how about we watch the Beastmaster trying to out-ham Vector Victor from Airplane?
You're here to take the water. It's the rarest, most valuable commodity you can imagine. Unlike most planets, ours included, Earth is blessed with an abundance of it. We need it, Mike, for our sustenance, and to power fusion generators, and the leader's weapons. We could have shared it. Some of us proposed that. But our leader wants it all.
We need to talk about water. Other than oxygen, it is the single most vital substance we consume. Given a neutral environment but denied water, the average human would not last a week. In what, for lack of a better word, I shall call the West, we as a culture appear to understand this, but since we've lived all our lives with water literally on tap, our understanding is still fairly esoteric. We tend to treat water as a distant deity, a giver of life, perhaps idly pondering the consequences should it suddenly depart. But to any of the estimated one-fifth of the world's population living in areas of water stress, these consequences are very real. Their plight occasionally filters down to us in the apocalyptic imagery of our media, creating in our minds a persistent, if remote, anxiety. This video is not about water scarcity, although I could certainly make one should the need arise. Rather, it is about the ways in which our culture's distant anxiety about water affects our view of the universe. If you pardon the pun, water is awash with paradoxes. It covers 70% of the Earth's surface, but makes up almost none of the Earth itself. It lies so deep on Earth's basins that its pressure can crush submersibles. Yet only about 1% of it is available to drink. This strange combination of ubiquity and scarcity even extends to the solar system. When glancing at our nearest neighbors, Mercury, a barren, blistering scab of a world. Venus, a roiling, seething hell. The Moon, a high-contrast, piebald wasteland. And Mars, an endless, freezing desert. It is tempting to see Earth, and its water, as a fragile, delectable jewel. A fitting prize for interstellar conquerors, such as those seen in V. And this is how, for the most part, we have chosen to see it. Ever since H.G. Wells, drawing on the ideas of Percival Lowell before him, sent an armada of rapacious Martians to our world, determined to claim its lush environs, quote, gray with water, with a cloudy atmosphere eloquent of fertility, for their dying desert planet, science fiction has chosen to see space as a frigid, desiccated void. From Edgar Rice Burroughs' Barsoom series, to Star Wars, Battlestar Galactica, and of course, Dune. But this image of space is not so much deceptive as completely and utterly wrong. The reason the inner solar system, our boondock corner of the cosmos out to the asteroids, is so starved of water, even while our own planet soaks in it, is because it happens to reside within blast range of an octillion tons of raging, imploding hydrogen nuclei that, over the course of 4.5 billion years, have done a fairly decent job of stripping any water from nearby surfaces. To see space as bereft of water is to lack the proper perspective. For us, water is a coveted treasure. On a universal scale, water is everywhere. To understand why, you must first turn to the stars. On a fundamental level, a star is what happens when gravity gets a hold of hydrogen. Hydrogen is the simplest form of matter in existence. In the vast majority of cases, it comprises just a single proton with an electron in orbit around it. When the universe began, 13 billion years ago, all matter, or at least all that we can see, was hydrogen, and today it makes up fully 74% of the visible matter in the universe. If the universe had remained completely homogeneous throughout its life, with hydrogen equally spaced in all directions, then nothing we know could have ever formed. Instead, instabilities formed in the clouds of hydrogen as they traveled through the cosmos, instabilities that gravity could tug like loose threads, pulling them into themselves, spiraling down into their own centers, crashing under their own weight until they reached such a density that at their cores, the hydrogen atoms, compressed by untold tons of matter above them, crushed into each other and fused. The single protons of hydrogen became the double protons of helium, element number 2, and in the process a vast amount of energy was released, enough to counterbalance the crushing weight of matter above, puffing out the ball of superheated hydrogen while its size and luminosity stabilized. Now powered by the rhythmic churn of fusion at its core, the ball of hydrogen became a star. I should note here that what I just described is a vast oversimplification. Some hydrogen fused into helium during the brief period when the universe itself was small enough for such pressures to exist. But on the whole, for any common element you've heard of, you should thank the alchemy of fusion within the cores of ancient stars. For about 90% of its life, a star quietly and unassumingly converts hydrogen to helium, with the rate of burning depending on its size. Somewhat paradoxically, perhaps, the smaller a star is, the longer it lives. Despite having up to hundreds of times more mass, and thus fuel, than our Sun, larger stars burn through that fuel incredibly quickly, with the largest exhausting their reserves in as few as 10 million years, 1/1000th our Sun's predicted lifespan. Conversely, the slow-burning embers known as red dwarfs will outlive our Sun by trillions of years. But eventually, the fuel available at its core will burn out, and the star will once again succumb to its gravity, as the core can no longer counter the pressure piled atop it. As the pressure builds, the temperature increases, until it reaches the titanic, searing levels needed to fuse helium into carbon, and then carbon into oxygen. Those elements between helium and carbon on the periodic table are more difficult to form via fusion, and so today are far less common. Most stars, including the Sun, will never produce any elements heavier than oxygen, and no stars can produce elements heavier than iron. Those rare elements heavier than iron are produced in supernova explosions, the cataclysmic deaths of giant stars that outshine entire galaxies. Because all stars spend their lives converting hydrogen into helium, helium into carbon, and carbon into oxygen, and 96% of stars will produce nothing beyond these elements, it follows that hydrogen, helium, carbon, and oxygen would be the commonest elements in the universe. But there is a slight hiccup. Because creating oxygen consumes carbon, by the end of their lives, stars have more oxygen than carbon in their makeup, which means that oxygen, despite being heavier than carbon, is actually the third most abundant element in the universe, after hydrogen and helium. And here, at last, we come back to water. Helium is inert. It interacts with nothing, and plays no role in chemistry. Unless they are caught by a star and fused into some heavier element, the clouds of helium formed at the beginning of the universe will still be those same clouds when the last stars have burned out eons from now. So if we are to speak of the cascading spiral of complexity that is the world we know, then we must exclude helium. The commonest reactive elements in the universe are thus hydrogen and oxygen. And what is the likeliest compound to form from those two elements? Hydrogen monoxide, H2O. While the precise relative abundance of the different compounds in the universe is still imperfectly known, there is no question that water is universal. It has been found in the vast clouds of gas and dust that give birth to stars and planets, in the spinning vortices around the earliest and most distant quasars, and of course, in our own solar system, where it forms the bulk of the solid material, mostly in the form of comets. Comets are dirty balls of ice, or, after a few swings around the sun, icy balls of dirt, that orbit the sun in chaotic and often destructive paths. They are known to originate in three principal reservoirs, the Oort cloud, a vast, light-year-wide sphere of planetesimals far beyond the known solar system, whose mass alone exceeds the entire inner solar system, the Kuiper Belt, a donut-shaped ring of objects beyond Neptune that includes the former planet Pluto, and most recently discovered, the outer edge of the asteroid belt. And this is why, in any interstellar setting in which faster-than-light travel is allowed, the idea of desert planets has always been fairly ludicrous. Luke's Uncle Owen need not have sweated on his moisture farm, nor the Fremen drain their dead of their bodies' water. A simple jaunt to the outer edges of their respective solar systems would have provided them with enough water to turn their planets green 1,000 times over. During the solar system's formation, below a point midway through the asteroid belt that astronomers half-jokingly call the snow line, high temperatures ensured that water and other substances with low melting points, such as methane, carbon monoxide, and ammonia, could not remain solid, and so could not play an appreciable role in formation. Thus, the solid bodies of the inner solar system, the Earth, Venus, Mars, the Moon, Mercury, and the innermost asteroids, are composed largely of elements with high melting points, such as iron and silica. In the modern solar system, the snow line is differently defined as the point at which solid water can exist in direct sunlight without boiling into gas, and lies just within the orbit of Jupiter. It is at this point in their journeys around the Sun that comets begin to form their beautiful tails. This does not mean, though, that icy bodies do not exist below this line. Ceres, the largest asteroid, is believed to be about 50% water ice by volume, but its innards are protected by the layer of regolith that covers its surface, despite the occasional impact. But, I hear you cry, if our home in the inner solar system formed devoid of water, then why is our world almost literally drowning in it? The truest answer is, we don't know. At least, not yet. Though there are a number of ideas. The two main hypotheses for the origins of Earth's water are that it was trapped within the planet as gas when it formed, and then erupted to the surface where it fell as rain, or that it was delivered by icy planetesimals such as comets or distant asteroids after the Earth's formation. The Earth's oceans contain roughly 10 to the 21 kilograms of water. The average comet contains about 10 to the 13 kilograms, which means that it would have taken about 10 to the 8, or 100 million impacts, to completely fill Earth's ocean basins. During the period known as the Late Heavy Bombardment, impact rates were 1,000 times higher than today, so our oceans could have been filled in less time than our species has been on the planet. It is important to note that these two ideas are not mutually exclusive. Both volcanism and impacts could have played a role in the process. Determining what exactly happened depends on the study of a peculiar form of hydrogen called deuterium. Most hydrogen, as I said earlier, consists of a single proton orbited by a single electron. But a small portion of the universe's hydrogen also sports an added neutron. Piling too many neutrons onto hydrogen makes it unstable, but a hydrogen atom can exist perfectly happily whilst lugging around just one, and while comparatively rare, these heavy hydrogen atoms, known as deuterium, are a normal feature of our universe. Water made from deuterium, known as D2O, or heavy water, is present in ocean water at a level of 156 for every million molecules of ordinary water. Heavy water, being, well, heavy, evaporates less easily than ordinary water, so the percentage of heavy water per ordinary water is a good indication of the temperature at which the water formed. The higher the proportion of heavy water, the warmer the temperature. Deuterium ratio measurements in comets have proven inconclusive. Measurements from Halley's Comet in 1986 showed that the deuterium ratio was twice that of Earth's oceans, while the recent Rosetta mission to 61P Chernomov-Gerasimenko showed its ratio to be nearly three times that of Earth's water. However, Deep Impact's long-distance measurements from Comet Hartley 2 gave a ratio of 161 per million, almost identical to Earth's oceans. The main issue with these measurements, both on Earth and of the comets, is, of course, that these ratios could have changed in myriad ways over the previous 4.6 billion years, from evaporation of Earth's oceans to simple exposure of comet surfaces to sunlight. As we send more and more spacecraft out to meet comets, we will hopefully get a wide enough sample of deuterium to answer this question once and for all. But in truth, this is only half the answer. For whichever mechanism ultimately gave the Earth its water, be it comets, volcanism, or both, the same mechanisms would have operated equally on all other worlds in the inner solar system. Mercury, Mars, the Moon, and Venus all show evidence of volcanic activity, as well as fairly obvious records of impacts. But they are utterly barren, while Earth's surface is a roiling, bounding maelstrom of water. Liquid water requires some form of pressurizing barrier to keep it from boiling into gas. On Earth, that barrier is its thick atmosphere. Simply being smaller than Earth is not an explanation. Titan, Saturn's largest moon, is smaller than Mars, yet possesses an atmosphere thicker than Earth's. Even without an atmosphere, water should still persist as ice, as it has on Ceres. So what happened? Well, the short answer is the sun. The sun emits far more than just sunlight. The storms and eddies on its surface eject massive amounts of plasma into the solar system at millions of miles per hour in a stream known as the solar wind. Today, the solar wind is a fairly quiet stream, only riling up every now and again to send bursts of plasma called coronal mass ejections towards Earth, which the Earth catches in its magnetic field, redirecting them towards the poles, where they discharge as the beautiful aurorae. Earth's magnetic field is believed to be our primary protection against the solar wind. Without it, the sun's periodic outbursts would excite the molecules in our atmosphere, causing them to bleed away into space. The poster child for this phenomenon is our closest upwind neighbor, Mars. Mars's atmosphere is currently just 0.6% as dense as Earth's, and its complete lack of an ozone layer means its surface is bombarded with radiation from the sun and cosmic rays. With no blanket to shield it from the frigid expanse of space, Mars is blastingly cold, with an average surface temperature of minus 63 degrees Celsius. However, evidence suggests that in the distant past, Mars's atmosphere was thicker and its climate warmer, warm enough to support liquid water. Evidence of this water lies all over the planet, from riverbeds and deltas to the shoreline of a vast, vanished northern ocean. Battle-hardened relics of this water still exist, occasionally boiling up from underground to form temporary rivers. Liquid water literally cannot last a second in Mars's thin atmosphere, or as ancient glaciers protected by coatings of sand and rock. Recent studies by NASA's MAVEN spacecraft have shown that deuterium levels in Mars's polar cap, where the largest portion of its ice remains, are 8 times higher than on Earth's oceans, meaning that it must have had far more water in the past. In 2009, the Mars rover Opportunity spotted an intact meteorite on Mars's surface, something that could only have survived if it was slowed by a thick atmosphere. In 2015, scientists at Glasgow University, Scotland, identified traces of opal in a Martian meteorite found in Egypt. Opal is a mineral that only forms in the presence of water, indicating that water must have existed on Mars for a substantial period of time. So if Mars once had a thick atmosphere and copious water, where did it go? Mars is far smaller than Earth, and so never got much of a magnetic field going. Magnetic fields require a spinning core of molten iron, and as tiny Mars lost its heat to space, that core gradually solidified and shrank, until it was no longer powerful enough to generate a magnetic field. Without its field, the solar wind gradually ate away its atmosphere until the pressure was too low for liquid water to exist and it boiled away. The subsequent bombardment by high-energy radiation and cosmic rays evaporated any ice left uncovered on the surface. By studying argon levels in Mars's atmosphere, MAVEN has revealed that Mars lost its atmosphere incredibly early and quickly. This must mean that during its early years, the sun's solar wind was far more violent and powerful than it is today, which would have buffeted the young planet's atmosphere into submission. Not only that, but MAVEN has shown that this still goes on today. In 2015, a shock in the solar wind hit Mars and increased atmospheric escape by a factor of 10. If Mars's fate was to die in the cold, then the fate of Venus was to meet all-consuming fire. Given all we have learned of Venus, it is truly remarkable how, from a distance, it resembles our planet. It is only slightly smaller and has an atmosphere completely covered in white, Earth-like clouds. It is only 30% closer to the sun than we are, but that slight distance might as well have been a banishment to hell. Venus is, by any definition, a nightmare world. Its atmosphere is 90 times as dense as Earth's, and composed almost entirely of a choking ocean of super-pressurized carbon dioxide, which cloaks Venus in an unrelenting, unchanging blanket of heat. Day or night, tropics or poles, Venus's surface temperature seldom varies from an average of 462 degrees Celsius, or 864 Fahrenheit. The clouds that have been so inviting to science fiction writers are composed not of water, but of sulfuric acid. Under these clouds, daylight on Venus is reduced to a long, bloody twilight, while the night sky is completely black, lit by a continuous barrage of lightning. How Venus's atmosphere can generate lightning when it contains just 20 parts per million of water is still unknown, though the sulfuric acid may play a role. Venus's surface is pockmarked with volcanoes and alien geological features, some of which are unique to that world. How could such a planet so superficially similar to Earth have ended up so different? The key appears to have been water. Opinions differ as to the extent of water's role, but evidence is growing that it was the loss of water early in its life that sent Venus on its descent into the Inferno. And among that evidence is, of course, deuterium. Deuterium hydrogen levels relative to Earth may be 8 times higher on Mars, but they are 150 times higher on Venus. Of course, Venus has far less water than Mars, but the implications are the same. At one point, Venus had a hydrosphere, perhaps even an ocean, but it was just too close to the Sun to hold on to it for long. Eventually, the increased temperatures caused it to slowly evaporate, leaving Venus a dry husk. On Earth, the oceans were able to absorb substantial quantities of carbon dioxide from the air, while its two unique processes, plate tectonics and life, sequestered even more. Plate tectonics is the driving force of Earth's geology. Unlike every other planet or moon in the solar system, Earth has a crust divided into a dozen or so vast plates, which collide with one another or are pushed downwards into the mantle, a process known as subduction, creating a pulling action that moves the continents across the surface. Life, in the form of microscopic plankton, used dissolved carbon in the oceans to create carbonate shells, which fell to the ocean floor upon death, whereupon the pull of subduction dragged it beneath the crust. There has been some speculation that the fact that Earth is the only known planet with life, and also the only known planet with plate tectonics, may not be a coincidence. Life obviously required water, but there is some speculation that plate tectonics required it as well. Water, it is argued, lowers the melting temperature of lava and decreases its viscosity, allowing subduction to take place. Venus's surface shows no evidence of recent tectonic processes, with the only recent geological action being volcanic. Impact crater counts suggest that Venus may not have seen any tectonic resurfacing for as long as 600 million years. It appears Venus died, ultimately, of dehydration. And then, there are the fossil worlds. Mercury and the Moon. At first, their cases would appear to be fairly simple. They were too small to retain atmospheres, and so lost their surface water to space. But in fact, the relationship between an object's size and its atmospheric retention is not clear-cut. Were they further from the Sun, both the Moon and Mercury could have retained substantial atmospheres. Both have higher surface gravities than Titan, which, as said before, has an atmosphere thicker than Earth's. But the combination of searing temperatures and the blast from the solar wind sent whatever atmospheres they may have had into the void long ago. But there is a twist to this tale. Both Mercury and the Moon have negligible axial tilts relative to the Sun. Unlike Earth, which is tilted by 23 degrees, and so eventually shows every part of itself to the Sun, Mercury and the Moon face the Sun straight on, and so possess small regions near their poles that never receive sunlight. Within these, quote, craters of eternal darkness, cometary ice has survived for millions of years, providing hope for future colonists. I hope that was a decent intro. Please join me in the next episode when we'll be climbing above the snow line to visit the solar system's ice worlds, weird, wonderful, and potentially alive.